Good morning, student. In today's class, we will see single phase half bridge inverter with RLC load. So, in my previous lectures, I will cover single phase half bridge topology with various loads such as R, L, RL loads. Now, we will study what is the output voltage nature or current nature according to RLC load. So, in VSI, it is a property that output load voltage waveform is independent of load current waveform for any kind of load. So, in this case, output voltage waveform remains same as in previous lectures for R, L, RL loads. So, in this case also, output voltage waveform is same in the square form nature, which is one is a periodic one and AC voltage waveform. So now we will see the circuit topology of this RLC load configuration. So this is the circuit topology in which two thyristor switches there and two diodes are there. So these two diodes are connected in anti-parallel with the two thyristor switches, and there is a load which is RLC, and this supply this is DC supply which is applied to inverter input. So it is divided into two parts for half bridge topology, which is VDC by 2 and VDC by 2. Reference polarities for the voltages and current are marked as shown in the figure. So we will study that the switching logic table is same for any kind of load, that is R, L, RL, RLC loads. So it is same as in previous cases. So now see what is the output current nature. So voltage waveform remains same. Now we will see what is the output current nature. So if DC excitation is applied to a RLC load, so if we will write the KVL equation and we will take Laplace transform, then we will see that it is a second order equation. So S square term will be there. So if we take further inverse Laplace transform, then we will see that the transient current waveform has a nature of sinusoidal one because it is a RLC load case. So RLC load case, if DC excitation is applied, then output current has a nature of sinusoidal one. So in this output current waveform as shown in the figure, we will draw it to be a sinusoidal one. So there are two case studies are there. First one is there that if XL greater than XC, so if in load has a XL is greater than XC, then it is a lagging case because L is greater than C. So it is a lagging load case. So current will be lagging to the voltage waveform by an angle of called it as phi. So phi is the angle which will be now calculated as a phi is equals to tan inverse of XL minus XC by R. So this is the case of inductive. So in control systems where we will study this case of RLC load where DC excitation applied, then it is a overdamped case. Why overdamped case? There will be a term zeta which will show the damping of the system. So in overdamped case, delta should be greater than or zeta should be greater than of 1, which shows the overdamping condition in case of the L is greater than of C. So and in case of XC greater than XL, it will be a leading load case. So we will draw the current waveform from some leading angle, say call it as a phi. So we will draw a leading load case. So we will draw from this or we extending this voltage waveform in the negative direction. So in leading load case, XC greater than XL, it is an underdamped condition because zeta is less than 1. Less than 1 or in case it, or we can say that it is between the 0 to 1. So this is a leading load case and above 1 is the lagging load case. So these are the volt current waveform which are sinusoidal in nature, as well as this for lagging load case it is just lagging by an angle phi, and in leading load case it is leading to a voltage by an angle of phi. Now we'll see the conduction of the devices. So this is a switching logic table. We have to mark the switching device of conductions according to this switching table. So as the thyristor T1 is on, V0 greater than 0, I0 greater than 0. But in this voltage and current waveform C, for 0 to T by 4, voltage is positive, which is VDC by 2. and current is negative. So voltage positive, current negative. So it is a diode D1 conducting according to switching logic table. So we mark the D1 to be conducting here. And in the similar way, we'll write the switching conduction by seeing the voltage and current waveform nature, that it is a positive one or a negative one. And similarly, in the case of leading load case, we can also write the switching device conduction in the diagram. So here the two terms are there, forced commutation as well as and self commutation. What are these terms? Forced commutation means we will have to apply external circuitry to turn off the thyristor switch, because we know thyristor has a turn on by applying the gate pulse, but in case of a turning off, there is no provision there in the thyristors. Although if we use GTO, that is gate turn off switch here, then we will not have to apply external circuitry to turn off the switch. But in this case, there is a thyristor switch, so we will apply the external circuitry to turn off this device. So forced commutation means we will have to apply external circuitry to turn off this device. And in the self-commutation, so self-commutation also known as a load commutation. So by polarity of the voltage or current, the device will be turned off. So it is a self-commutation or load commutation case. So in our damped case and in self-commutation case, so first we will see the self-commutation case. So see in the waveform, S1 is conducting and after that D1 is conducting. So in the diagram, see, if the D1 is conducting, then after S1, D1 is conducting. So if the D1 is conducting, then it will apply reverse voltage to this thyristor T1. So it will be turned off by applying this negative voltage across the by the diode. So it will automatically turn off. So it is a self commutation case, because we have not to apply any circuitry here. By this conduction of D1, reverse voltage appears across the thyristor, so it will be automatically turned off. So it is a self commutation case. So this will occurs in case of leading load case or underdamped case. But in case of lagging load case, after T1, D2 will be conducting. So after T1, D2 will be conducting. So see that T1 and D2. So there is no impact of D2 on the conduction of T1. So here, no reverse voltage polarity of this diode will make the thyristor T1 to be off. So it is a forced commutation case. So we will have to apply provision for this turning off of this thyristor T1. So it is a forced commutation case. So in case of leading load case, self commutation is possible, while in the case of lagging load case, forced commutation will not self commutation will not possible. So this is the very important case for the exam point of view. So self and forced commutation we will see in this Hartree topology. Now we will see the conduction of the diode. So conduction of the diode. So diode D1 will be conducting from 0 to 5 in the lagging load case, and in the case of leading load case, it is also conducting for a 5 angle. So each diode will be conducting for an angle of 5. If we want to know what is the conduction angle of thyristor, so we will see that for 5 to pi, thyristor T1 or switch S1 will be conducting. So it is a duration of pi minus 5. So each thyristor will be conducting for an angle of pi minus 5. And third point is there, self commutation is possible only in leading power factor. So we will already see this in above. So self commutation is possible in the leading power factor load. So circuit turnoff time. What is circuit turnoff time? It is the time for which thyristor will remains in off condition. So it is a circuit turnoff time, and it is denoted by the TC. So see in the diagram. So thyristor will be turned off when diode D is conducting. So diode will be conducting for an angle of 5. So it is a circuit turnoff time is 5 there, because when the diode is conducting, the thyristor remains off. So circuit turnoff time omega t equal to 5 or TC equal to 5 divided by omega. Or what is the 5? How we will calculate the 5? Phi equals to power factor angle. So phi is equals to tan inverse of XC minus XL by RY, because it is a leading case, so XC should be greater than XL. So tan inverse XC minus XL divided by R. Now we'll continue the further parameter calculation. So it is a Fourier series. So in case of Fourier series, it is the same as in previous case, because output or load voltage waveform is independent of the any kind of low. So it is similar as summation n equals to 1 3 5 to infinite 2 v dc divided by n pi sin n omega t. And if you want to write for the output current waveform, then it will be similar, but what we divide it by a impedance of the load. So it is a Zn, and sin n omega t plus minus phi n. So why we'll write plus minus phi n? Because current either will be lagging or leading. So plus for the leading case and minus for the lagging case. If we want to write the impedance and this power factor angle of the load in terms in case of lagging case, so we will write Zn equals to root over of R square plus XL minus XC whole square, because we will calculate for this to be lagging load case. So it is XL minus XC whole square. So XL equal to N omega L, put N omega L. So N, it is a harmonic number. And phi n equals to tan inverse of n omega naught l minus 1 upon n omega naught c xl minus xc divided by r. So it is a lagging load case. Simply we will also write for the leading load case by simply putting xc greater than xl in these expressions. And now we calculate the fundamental power factor angle. What is the FDF fundamental displacement factor? It is the angle between the fundamental voltage and fundamental current. So it is a cos phi 1. Phi 1 we will calculate from our expression by putting n equals to 1. Similarly, diode and switch current waveforms for fundamental. So fundamental waveforms are shown in the above diagram through which diode have a waveform of 0 to 5. It is a sinusoidal in fashion, and for the thyristor, it will be phi to pi. It is a part of this waveform is shown here. So we will calculate either it for a lagging or leading load case. It is the same as C above. For lagging as well as leading load case, it is a sinusoidal one. So we will take either a part of from phi. We will want to calculate the fundamental components RMS value. So we will take either a lagging load case or leading load case. Conduction will be same for the thyristors and diodes. So if we want to calculate the average RMS current of these fundamental components of current across the diodes and the thyristors, so ID01 average, there is a fundamental current across the diode, and we want to calculate the average value. So how we calculate the average value? Simply applying 1 upon 2 pi 0 to 5, because it is conducting for 0 to 5, and I01 maximum, which is a fundamental component's maximum value, and sine omega naught t minus phi 1. Phi 1 why? Because we will take the lagging load case here. So we put the n equals to 1 for the fundamental and with minus phi 1 d omega t. By applying this, we will calculate the average. And for RMS, simply square this waveform for the average one and take the root mean of this waveform. So it is a RMS calculation. Similarly, for thyristor, we calculate by applying the limits for phi to pi. And for RMS, we will square the waveform and take the root mean of these. So in this way, we will complete the RLC load case for the half bridge configuration. So in next lectures, we will continue with the full bridge topology, and we will see what is the circuit topology for the full bridge configuration and what are the benefits of full bridge configuration. Thank you.